What's going on, everybody? C4 here. Welcome back to the channel, and we're here today for our newest episode of our Madden 21 Realistic Rebuild series, and we are here in Carolina. Matt Rule, new era has begun for the Carolina Panthers, and it's like, the reason why I wanted to do this is like, me and my buddies were talking about football the other night, and I was like, I was dead wrong with Teddy Bridgewater. When Teddy Bridgewater came to the Carolina Panthers, I thought 1,000% they overpaid to have a placeholder quarterback for them to kind of suck this year to play themselves into consideration for probably not Trevor Lawrence, but the second-tier quarterbacks. They may be there for Justin Fields or Trey Lance, and now you have Wilson from BYU. You could argue Kyle Trask from Florida, Mac Jones from Alabama. Like, there are some very legitimate quarterback prospects this year, and I thought Teddy Bridgewater was going to be that stopgap quarterback, that Band-Aid quarterback that, you know, maybe there's a chance that they could salvage him. But for the most part, he's just going to be a guy that's there for this year and will be the mentor to whatever quarterback they draft. Teddy Bridgewater's been pretty damn good. I've been impressed by Teddy Bridgewater. Now, is Teddy Bridgewater a quarterback that can lead this Carolina Panthers team to the playoffs with a healthy Christian McCaffrey? Maybe. But I think I could say, even though I had to fully admit up front that I was wrong about Teddy Bridgewater and the success that he's been able to have with Carolina, I don't see a guy, though, that's going to be able to like elevate a team from a contender to a Super Bowl contender. So how I'm going to take this rebuild, it's going to be more so what quarterbacks are available. If there is a legitimate quarterback available here in the 2021 draft, I'll probably pull the trigger. If not, we'll see what Teddy Bridgewater has, because I did do a rebuild earlier on in Madden 21 with the Panthers, and the whole idea of the rebuild was to stick with Teddy Bridgewater. Didn't really work out too well. I mean, he's 27-78 star dev. I feel like he had a normal dev at the beginning of Madden 21, so maybe that was working against him. But I'm not inherently, because it didn't work before, the roster's drastically different. I'm not going to say I'm going to force drafting a quarterback if Teddy plays well. If we're going to get 30-plus touchdowns, Teddy Bridgewater, maybe we'll make this a Teddy rebuild with the Carolina Panthers. But we're going to keep ourselves open to potentially bringing in another QB. Looking at the rest of the roster here, obviously with Christian McCaffrey, I think the best running back in the National Football League. You have Mike Davis, who this year, when Christian McCaffrey's out doing the injury, Mike Davis looked pretty goddamn good. So what we're actually going to do is I'll throw him up in the trade block just to see what we could get. But injuries are on. So if McCaffrey does go down injury, we should feel confident that Mike Davis can step up and be serviceable, if not good, in relief duty. He's not McCaffrey good, but Mike Davis was a guy who's still getting like, 100 yards from scrimmage plus. You know, all you Mike Davis fantasy owners probably could tell me exactly the kind of stats he was putting up. The wide receiving core, that the three-headed monster has been sensational. Robbie Anderson coming over from the Jets to reunite with his college head coach has been amazing. He is literally, you know, he's not a top five wide receiver, but he's producing like a top five wide receiver. And then you have DJ Moore, who's, you know, it might be unfair to call him a gadget player, because really, you know, DJ Moore and Curtis Samuel do a lot of different things. They're not just strictly wide receivers, but they're both elite athletes. They're both guys that are dangerous with the ball in their hands. DJ Moore, more so than Curtis Samuel, is a pretty damn good wide receiver. So you combine all three of these guys. I mean, Curtis Samuel played a little bit, almost feels like he's running back, wide receiver. Yeah, he doesn't really have a true position. But, I mean, it's scary. Wait, like, this was why these three guys alone, I mean, I don't know if things would have been different, but these three guys alone were why I didn't want to use Carolina as my main channel franchise, and I went with Detroit, is I was like, this is going to be too overpowered. These three guys are way too overpowered. So hopefully they continue to be overpowered here in the Madden sim. I have no idea how well they're going to play together, but hopefully they play well. Tight end is, a little less than ideal. Things have changed since Greg Olsen left town. You have Ian Thomas here. Maybe there's something we can do there. Manhurts is more of a blocking tight end, so definitely in the market to upgrade the tight end spot here for the Carolina Panthers. Good thing is that usually in Madden franchise, there are a tight end or two in free agency that you can look to sign and bring in. Offensive line, we have Okun, who's serviceable for the time being. Very expensive, and hopefully you can just kind of mentor Greg Little, who we could be our, long-term starter. Our left guard, we have Dennis Daly. Young, but not a great base starting overall. Matt Paradis at center. He does have a star dev trait, which we can, work with and milk as long as we possibly can. Right guard, not great either. And then at right tackle, you have Taylor Moten, who's definitely the best lineman on this team. 26, star dev. Got himself, I think, must not be. There's no way he got locked in a new contract. But his contract's coming up and definitely be one of the players that we need to pay sooner than later. Defensively, you got Brian Burns, beast. I think it might be even a little bit harsh to already knock him down. I'm pretty sure he had a superstar dev last year and they just gave him a star. I think the potential's there for him to stay as a superstar dev, but I'm a big fan. I thought that was an outstanding pick 2 years ago when they got him out of Florida State. Thought he should have went way higher. Thought he should have been a fringe top 10 pick. But, hey, Panthers are reaping the rewards there. He's a sensational edge rusher with a very high ceiling. Same goes with Gross Matos, a guy I personally had a first-round grade on. Slipped to the Carolina Panthers in the second round. He's already a 75 overall with a hidden dev trait. So the good news for this Panthers rebuild is we already have our two edge rushers set in stone. Defensively, you have Derrick Brown, who, again, has been amazing. He was my safest player in the 2020 draft, and he has been very good. He was a guy that came in as a known run defender, and he's showing awesome pass rushing ability this year. So I think that, honestly, K'Juan Short, he's, you know, legend, I think you could argue, for the Carolina Panthers. While he's a little bit older, three of our four defensive line are set in stone for the remainder of this rebuild. So I like having that stability, the pillars of this defense. Shaq Thompson is a really athletic linebacker. I remember when he was at University of Washington, literally played everything. Pretty sure he played linebacker, he played safety, he played running back. Yeah, he's pretty damn good. So, not Luke Kuechly good. Luke Kuechly's a generational player, but Shaq Thompson is good enough. We got Tahir Whitehead and Jermaine Carter Jr. for the linebacking core. But in reality, hopefully, we're just going to be running a lot of nickel, and we'll just have Shaq Thompson, and then Mr. Jeremy Chinn will operate as our other player. For the sake of just the depth chart, though, I'm going to take Jeremy Chinn here and just make him a strong safety, just for Madden's sake, to help out his reps and stuff like that in the sim. But in reality, we probably could also just make him a linebacker. I wonder where his rating goes. He's a 78. If I just make him a right outside linebacker, 76. I'm going to do that because you know why? Because these guys go up depth trade. And I'm going to kind of cheese it. Because in reality, I can tell you right now, my fantasy league, I had him as a DB, and then they just switched him to a linebacker. He's doing it all right there. He's really like your sub-linebacker. But for the sake of Madden and knowing that he's already probably, what, star dev? He could end up a superstar dev entering year two. I think it's for the better long-term longevity of this squad to have him there as a right outside linebacker. Hopefully he's on the field a lot. Secondary with Dante Jackson, a lot of speed, solid corner. They got Rasul Douglas from the Philadelphia Eagles. I have no idea how well he's been doing. He got a 78. He was never that high of an overall when he was with Philly. Rasul Douglas is a guy. Now here's a guy. Honestly, given this if I was a GM, I would probably try to put Rasul Douglas at safety. He's just slow. He's too damn slow, but he has ball skills. He can actually tackle fairly well, but we don't really have much there at corner. But I will keep that open. If we go into free agency and I can land another corner, I mean, really, there's not a lot to be excited about here. I mean, Troy Pride, I think he's been kind of playing like shit in real life, but in Madden, 2269 is not that bad. Like, I'd rather give him reps over Corn Elder. But if we can bring in a corner, there's a chance that maybe we re-sign Rasul Douglas and we look at him as a strong safety. We got Trey Boston here. The strong safety spot in particular is not that special. Joey Sly is becoming one of my favorite kickers in Madden and therefore in the league. I love that they tried to break the field goal record. What was it, 2 weeks ago? I love that they didn't even attempt it and he had the distance. It was just wide. So an absolute cannon of a leg. We have Polardi there. I don't know why we have two punters. We don't really need to, even though the other punter is a little bit more expensive. It is what it is. It has some good damn special teams. So with that being said, I feel like, I don't know, let's get right into week where we are. We're in week 10. Week 10 just finished. So let's get right up to week 10, see where Carolina is, how does it relate to where they are in real life, and then we'll start hopping into games and so on and so forth. All right, so we caught up. This is present day where the Carolina Panthers are in the 2020 season. In real life, they're 3-7. In the Madden, 4-6. So pretty good that we're in like the same ballpark for sure. In terms of the team, like they're developing nicely. Everyone's kind of progressing. I did have a breakout scenario, actually, oddly enough, on the defensive side for Rasul Douglas, who didn't hit it, but he's up to an 80 overall. We have the hidden dev traits have been unveiled. Gross Matos is a star. Derrick Brown is a superstar. Jeremy Chinn is a star. And I don't think we had any on the offensive side of the ball. So it's still a really good foundation for us going forward for this five-year period to turn this team into a Super Bowl champion. What are they? Two Super Bowl appearances, fortunately two losses. Let's change that. I think Matt Rhule is the kind of guy that can turn it around. So we are third place in the NFC South, 4-6 behind the 5-5 Bucks and the 6-3 Saints. Statistically, I mean, Teddy's actually playing worse than what he is in real life. I mean, from a yard standpoint, yeah, all those numbers are pretty shit. So I mean, we can't kind of go off of what's happening in real life. We got to go with the sim. And right now, it's trending towards getting a quarterback in the first round. Running the ball, McCaffrey's been solid. You know, 700 yards, averaging 73 yards per game. Probably should be a little bit higher, but it's not too bad. I don't think we've had any major injuries. So you're looking at these numbers. Receiving numbers aren't particularly great. Definitely want to see more out of DJ Moore. Definitely probably want to see more numbers for Christian McCaffrey out the backfield. Defensively, Jeremy Chinn's being a beast. 74 tackles, 7 TFLs. We got 5 sacks, Brian Burns. 3 picks, Shaq Thompson leading the team. So a little bit underwhelming. How are we these numbers in the 13th offense in the NFL is what I want to know. And defensively, not good enough. Contracts. So at the midway point, we got a little bit of money. I'm pretty sure we're in a good spot salary cap-wise. So who is looking for a new deal? Work on the way. The guys that we can, John Miller, don't care. No. I like Katie Robbins because he's young. We might be able to develop him into something. So I'll straight up just give him a 5-year deal, see if he wants to take that. No. Definitely want Joey Sly here. Let's give him a 4-year. We knocked that signing bonus down just a little bit. He's still happy with it, so we'll do that. Rasul Douglas, that's an intrigue. Never thought I'd want to give Rasul Douglas a new contract, but he's an 80 somehow. He wants more money. Curtis Samuel, I like keeping the wide receivers together. If we can, that three-headed monster. I mean, Robbie Anderson's going to hit that point. He's older than everyone. But for the time being, let's try to do that. Moten for sure on the offensive line. Give him a 4-year deal. Keep him here until he's 30. So our salary cap's in a good spot. We absolutely will be able to re-sign Rasul Douglas. Absolutely be able to re-sign Joey Sly and Kenny Robinson. We already got him locked up. So, hey, good piece of business here for the Carolina Panthers, making sure we retain our best players. So that being said, I feel now it's time. It's a good time to hop in. Week 11, Detroit, both similar record-wise. Both probably fight for the same kind of positional spot in the NFC playoff race as kind of outsiders looking in. But still a legitimate shot to potentially crack into the wild card. So let's see if we can get a little bit of separation here and beat the 4-5 Detroit Lions. Oh. All right. Well, great first run from Christian McCaffrey. Gain of 15. I'll take a little bit of shot here. It's all fine and dandy being able to run the ball with Christian McCaffrey, but that's easy mode. Let's see what we can do with Teddy here. Oh, he's picking on the linebacker, and Samuel gets up, and it's intercepted. Justin Coleman. And by Justin Coleman, I mean Daron Harmon. All right. I'm not mad at that shot, though. Not mad. Ill-advised. But in the great words of Bruce Arians, no risk it, no biscuit. Got him. Go all the way. Go all the way. Robbie Anderson, height, weight, speed, athlete on the outside. Gets Teddy on the board. Pulls one back. Hopefully that interception is now a distant memory inside the brain of Theodore Bridgewater. Duke. Oh, get in. Oh, so close, but my God. It's like something I am noticing in Madden 21 is that if you don't have like the juke abilities, your juke sucks. But as soon as you get those juke abilities, your juke is incredibly overpowered. I feel like there needs to be a little bit of a balance there. Needs to be just a slight balance to make Christian McCaffrey still feel head and shoulders above the rest. But, you know, I'm someone that I've complained about like the lack of juking ability in some of my normal dev players that probably should have some form of juking ability. Well, this is outstanding for McCaffrey as he punches one in and Carolina takes the lead. All right, no, Hayes deep ball kind of sucks in Madden, huh? Hayes deep ball kind of sucks in Madden, huh? Find that out the hard way. That has to be it. He had him beat. Oh. Oh, man. We're just going to do that. I'm just going to run the ball. Madden 20 meta all over again. Come on, McCaffrey. Get it. Thank you. Thank you. Second and 4 here on the 12. I actually kind of want to go slants tease DJ Moore. I want to get him involved in the offense. It was kind of actually defended well, but they just gave up on tracking him across the middle of the field because it's slants. DJ Moore's in. Maybe we can finish 3 touchdowns, 3 picks, break even with Teddy Bridgewater. You know, a nice 1 KD for all you COD fans out there. Oh, we got him. Robbie Anderson deep. That's actually a hell of a route. They just don't have the athletes to match up on the back end, Detroit. They got Jeff Okuda, that's about it, that can run stride for stride with the likes of Robbie Anderson, with the likes of DJ Moore, with the likes of Curtis Samuel. And with that, we broke even. Three touchdowns, three picks. Teddy Bridgewater, dare we go, you know, above that? 4-3? Can we do that? Get it. Oh my God, he pulled like a what do you call it? No, I'm not going to have that. We're not pulling a Nick Chubb where he just takes a dive. I'm helping out some fantasy owners here. Give it to McCaffrey. There's a reason why. I know there's some people out there that drafted McCaffrey one overall, and I run my organizations to help out the fantasy owner here. Let's go. It's good victory. Outside of the interceptions, it's a very good victory. Three touchdowns, almost 200 yards for McCaffrey, 200 yards for Robbie Anderson. A little bit of, turnover happy, but I know I've been playing COD for the last 4 days straight. A little bit rusty with Matt. A little bit rusty on the stick, still found a way to win. All right, just before the bye, we have 2-8 Vikings, so it should be a winnable game. Christian McCaffrey's coming off a Offensive Player of the Week performance, which, that's what we did. We got him touchdowns. We fed him contracts. So with Rasul Douglas, we'll give him a little bit more salary here. Bumped up like 3-8 probably, 4 years, $24 million. Got him locked up. Joey Sly wants a little bit more money. Probably give him 2.5. Should be nice. Mr. Bearded Man. So that'll be about it for contracts. So let's see what happens as we get ready for the bye. Everyone's excited for the week. Should be able to knock off a 2-win Vikings team going to the bye happy. Of course not. Breakout scenario here for Curtis Samuel. Wide receiver 3. Looking to go to a superstar dev trade. Just got a brand new contract, so I'd love for him to achieve that. Oh. Breakout for Teddy. That's pretty tough. That's a tough one to swing for Teddy. 4 total touchdowns. He hasn't really been playing that well. Let's just see. Can we hit it in the sim? Now, he won the game. Highly doubt it that Teddy actually hit those performances, but we'll see. There's a chance. No. Close. But hey, you got the win. At this point, a win's a little bit more important. So for scouting here, I've done pretty much all the known positions that we need to try to fix. I got quarterback scouting done. Tight ends. I scouted some of the tackles. More so, we just need an upgrade over Okun. We're good on the defense, so D-tackle. Finding that long-term partner for Derek Brown. We got that scouting done. We're good at linebacker for the most part. Looking at corners at this point now, I'm into the day 3, just more so trying to get guys that could potentially be scheme fits. TJ Carter actually looks like some pretty good value. And pretty much just want to finish with safeties. I think strong safety is a spot that we could definitely look to improve upon. So I will scout out pretty much every safety, because really in today's NFL, a safety is a safety, right? So we will scout the remaining top 3 safeties here, and then I'll probably just turn on the auto scout to finish out the year. Upgrades. I like upgrading after a dub. I think all these guys here are scheme fits. Of course, Matos, scheme fit, right? Run stuffer. Well, I know sometimes if you just auto spend when things are tied, I almost feel like Madden purposely like just doesn't go for your scheme fit. So we'll do that. I know Derek Brown's not a pass speed rusher. Might take a hit. Yeah, I didn't go up an overall there. Pretty much my way of thinking is like if you're 25 and under, if you're 25 and under, I try and just up your points into the scheme. And then there comes a point in time, like, for example, like physical, right? There's no way in hell that DJ Moore, Curtis Samuel, Robbie Anderson are a physical style wide receiver. They're all finesse speedsters. So on DJ Moore's case, I mean, he's on the right side of 25. So that I can afford to not necessarily have him go up that overall chunk. And I can make him more of a productive member of my team in terms of earning XP. But someone like Robbie Anderson, who's like 27... like, now you're almost like, I need to prepare him for that regression that's going to hit when he's 29, 30. And you just can't afford to pump those points into scheme fit. So that's kind of my rule of thumb in my rebuilds, is that if they're under 25, let's pump it into the scheme fit. If they're over 25, just continue to try to give them the highest overall possible. Week 16, coming off a loss there against the Packers. That was kind of rough. You could definitely see that was an important game. Packers are the 6th seed. You know what? This is actually kind of cool. For like at least my rebuilds, where we go through season by season, having something like this to just keep like refreshing and checking and seeing where we are at in the playoffs. Yeah, I guess it's good eye candy. It's positive. Something that's, more of an addition to franchise than it is a deterrent, which is always a positive. Let's just finish scouting out here. The safeties, Reed Blankenship, Bubba Bolden, Sean Davis, Harvey Pell. All right, well, we're pretty much done there. I'll auto-scout for the rest of the year. We got two big games here. We have the 3-11. Let's hop in. We'll play, like, again. I just, for the most part now, I don't know if this is something that people really want to see me play offense and defense, but we'll hop in, play offense only, hopefully smoke Washington, pull one game back, and see if we can improve our odds to make the playoffs. Week 17, divisional game against the Saints. Got it, man. We got it in. I was going to say, man, the deep ball. Teddy is not great given the wide receivers we have, but DJ Moore with the filthy extension. Let's get a quick play there before we see a potential laundry on the field for a challenge flag. Get Curtis Samuel here out in space. Yeah, it was well read. Well read by football team. Ooh, McCaffrey on the hitch. Let's just go right in the middle of the field. Blown play by the football team defense, Ian Thomas. Week 16, better than letting than never to get your first receiving touchdown of the year. He's like 600 yards. Oh, he's too fast. He's too fast. He takes the slant because he's too fast for you. DJ Moore, 70-some yards. 75, that's... Second and four on the 24. This play was the blown play. Maybe it's just our money. This is just a money play. They are not covering Ian Thomas. They do not respect it. And I'm just going to... I'll just keep targeting it if I have to. First and goal on the 3. Actually, kind of like Christian McCaffrey here. Nope. Linebacker's right there. That's a risky pass. In a 2. It's time just to let McCaffrey do what he does best. That's what he's known for. Red zone... Short yardage running back. I don't know. Oh, we have 2 o'clock on. It's taking way too long. But it is a wide open touchdown. The lead only strengthens as we enter halftime. Here we go. Deep bomb. Deep bomb, DJ Moore. I feel like DJ Moore's stats are pretty shitty this year. So we're going to help him out this game, try to force feed him a little bit. Okay. That was excellent from both players. Teddy Bridgewater getting destroyed by Chase Young. The adjustment, the low catch and grab by DJ Moore to make a couple guys miss. And then you got Christian McCaffrey just truck sticking the shit out of someone. Let's go! Second goal on the 4. Probably should just have McCaffrey run this one in. But again, I want to try to force feed DJ Moore when I can. Just help him out a little bit. Make his stats a little bit more reflective of the talent that he is. Getting him a second touchdown. He's well over 200 yards today. Okay, so, you know, Connor was never really in the playoffs. Got that nice victory over football team. Lost week 17 against the Saints. It is what it is, man. It's kind of on par. I feel like, honestly, everything that happened year one in this, it's kind of, you know, on pace of what the Panthers are in real life here in the season. We finished 7-9. Third place in the NFC South. That's probably how things are going to play out there record-wise for the bottom two teams. I don't know necessarily if the Saints or the Bucks will have that much wins, but, you know, who knows? Saints gets got a bad injury there to Drew Brees. Bucks are very hot and cold. But let's look at our team. Stats, statistically, what's going on? Teddy Bridgewater, well, he had a top, almost top 10 offense. Fringe top 10, coming in number 11. Defensively 20th, so nothing brutal about that. Teddy, 3,700 yards. 26 touchdowns, 20 picks. Yeah, probably going to be drafting a quarterback in the first round. Running the ball, we got almost 1,300 yards, 12 touchdowns. McCaffrey, nice for our receiving. 67 catches, 950 yards, 11 touchdowns for Robbie Anderson. That's a good year for him. 8-4, DJ Moore is, you know, yardage-wise. Yeah, that's not a brutal year. 750-3 for Curtis Samuel. I mean, there's only so much to go around, especially with the stats that Teddy Bridgewater had. 680-1 for Ian Thomas. Madden needs to, like, the dev team needs to figure out how to properly represent Christian McCaffrey in the sim. because he needs to be having way more than 26 catches. I don't even think there's any, like, playbooks, though. Like, I don't think I've seen, through all the different teams I've played, like, a running back get much more, like, I don't think I've ever seen a running back in a Madden sim get more than 50 catches, which should exist in today's NFL. Defensively, Jeremy Chinn led the team, 118 tackles, 12 TFLs, 100 tackles there for Shaq Thompson as well, 5 TFLs, 4.5 sacks, 3 picks, good year. But Jeremy Chinn, that's like Defensive Rookie of the Year type numbers. 8 sacks, Brian Burns, 14 TFLs, happy with that. 15-8 for the veteran, K'Wan Short, like that. 7-5, Mattos, solid. 17 TFLs for Derek Brown, 2 sacks. Sacks are what they are, but those TFLs are outstanding. On interception front, Shaq Thompson led the team. Burris, strong safety, we're actually going to be trying to replace in the draft. Not a bad year. 2 picks, Dante Jackson for our best corner. Yearly awards, MVP went to... All right. Oh, and Kaepernick there at 4. It's one of those years. It's one of those years, huh? All right. Bulls got Offensive Player of the Year, Defensive Player of the Year, Bobby Wagner. Got Shaq at number 10. Offensive Rookie of the Year went to DeAndre Swift. I don't think we had anyone. Defensive Rookie of the Year. Just me? Chris Barnes? Who doesn't even have a picture? Jeremy Chinn, runner-up. Derek Brown at 8. Gross Mattos at 9. Okay, let me see. What kind of year did Chris Barnes have? He's not a basketball player. Oh, honestly, I know a lot about the draft and draft players. I cannot tell you a thing about Chris Barnes. Big 10, maybe? Oh, UCLA. 130. I mean, that's actually like a really good year. All right. Valid, I suppose. Valid. Let's look at the rest of the awards here real quick. Just to see if we got any. Do we have anyone else that's worthy? Quarterback, nothing. Running back, Christian McCaffrey was the top running back. Wide receiver, probably got Robbie Anderson in here somewhere. Number 5. Lineman, nobody. D lineman. K'Wan Short at 7. Brian Burns at 10. Best linebacker. Shaq Thompson at 8. Best DB, maybe? Nope, no one. Best kicker, Joey fucking Sly, baby. Sly's a dog. The cannon. Missile on the end of that leg. Very, very nice. So, had some individual success, team success. Pretty much on par for where the Panthers are in real life. Let's get in the offseason. Pro Bowlers. Who do we got? McCaffrey, running back 1. Nice. Anybody? K'Wan Short, D-tackle 2. Jeremy Chinn, right outside linebacker 2. Jeremy Chinn making his first Pro Bowler as a rookie. Yo, Joey Sly, kicker. Beautiful. What kind of depth chart? Look at the playoff bracket. What do we got here? All right. Okay. The Bears are a goddamn juggernaut. Nick Foles and the Bears. Nick Foles back in the Super Bowl against the Chargers. Absolutely a Super Bowl that I wouldn't give two shits about. Let's see who wins. Who wins? Who's the better team? Actually, can I get any upgrades here? Joey Sly, kicker of the year. Upgrade his accuracy, because he has 99 kick power, modern day. You know why I like Joey Sly so much? Because he's pretty much, I'm going to give him a dev trait as well. See, at certain times, when you win kicker of the year and you made the Pro Bowl and you still don't go up a dev trait because kicker dev traits don't exist, I'm going to give you a nice little dev trait boost there for Joey Sly. But you know why I like Joey Sly so much? Because he's pretty much like this generation, Sebastian Janikowski now. I mean, not from a draft standpoint, because that was ridiculous, but in terms of just meme ability, I think Joey Sly's right in that territory. So the Super Bowl here between the Bears and the Chargers. I'm going to say Bears. BDN gets the job done, and he does. Justin Herbert, he's a rookie. That's a tough sell. Nick Foles wins MVP. Nick Foles probably won Super Bowl MVP. It's wrong. It shouldn't happen, but it did happen, and I'm not super mad at it. Let's see if we have any dev trait increases on the offensive side of the ball. Not one. Defensive side of the ball. Brian Burns now up to a superstar. Shaq Thompson up to the superstar. Moving Jeremy Chinn to linebacker. Took him from that hidden star dev up to a superstar. We know how to abuse this Madden system to work for our team, and I feel freaking great about it. But also, even though we like to critique, both Shaq Thompson and Jeremy Chinn had kind of seasons that maybe rightfully so they went up dev trait. So let's just kind of focus on the positives there and get into the first wave of free agency and try to improve this squad before the draft. So as we entered free agency, we had about $40 million bucks. And, you know, it's an upgrade where appropriate. And I have two players that I was able to like. There's top guys right there. You know what it is. But I have two guys that I really like to look at. First up, Jonnu Smith. Year older than Ian Thomas, but he's, you know, nine spots better. Has a better dev trait. I think he's just another, like, piece. If I'm looking at the Panthers offense, how just explosive they could be. Jonnu Smith, another guy, like, he's, you know, trending more towards a receiver than he is, like, a true tight end. And that'd just be, like, you know, unstoppable. Like, how, like causing opposing DC's headaches between Christian McCaffrey. Now you throw in Jonnu Smith, DJ Moore, Robbie Anderson, Curtis Samuel. It'd be nice. And I actually personally do like the fact that they got rid of the numbers here on free agency. It's kind of a little bit more of a fog of war. You don't really know what the bids are. You can't just continually try to, you know, outpoint the other team. It's, you know, there's a little bit more gamble to it. And then the guy that beat Jeremy Chiff Rook of the Year is sitting there in free agency. I guess he's UDFA or something like that for the Packers. I was like, all right, need a middle linebacker? Why not? No other bids on him. So sure, Chris Burns, don't know a thing about you. Hopefully you land on our squad. And there's one less position we have to worry about in the draft. And through the first wave, we got both Jonnu Smith and Chris Burns added to the team. We have an upgrade here for Burns because obviously he won Defensive Rookie of the Year. Didn't go up dev trait, which is a little bit surprising, but it is what it is. I'm not going to lie. Personally, if I was writing the code, if I was writing the algorithm, I would say if you win any award whatsoever and you're a normal dev, should automatically go up. If you make the Pro Bowl, normal dev should probably go up. Maybe not automatically if you make the Pro Bowl, but I feel like you need to get some of these guys off that old bronze dev trait. I'm not overly, I mean, we're done pretty much scouting here, so let's go right to the draft. There might be a fifth-year option on McCaffrey? Nope, DJ Moore, fifth-year option. We will pick it up because DJ Moore is still a very, very good player. And yes, sir. I kind of forget DJ Moore is a first-round pick. I was thinking already, it's like, was he? Did they get him in the second round? He's coming out of Maryland. And then I remember he like had a crazy combine. And it makes sense that he snuck into the first round. So going to the draft, we're going to sim up to our pick, and you guys in the comment section below are going to help me with the decision. So we're going to go right away to our draft pick. I'm not going to mess around with trading up, even though we are in the market for a quarterback. And usually when you're in the market for a quarterback, you have to trade up. But we're just sitting here fine and pretty at pick 13. Please just don't have Trevor Lawrence there. There's no way he's still there. All right. So if you look at our team, before we even get into our pick, you look at our team right now, understanding where Teddy was at, we're at a spot that if there was absolutely no quarterback available to us, we could probably rock and roll with Teddy for another year. He's still 79, and we're not really at any risk of him regressing for at least another year with that star dev. He's already paid, can't really get over his contract. But when you look at this squad, you're like, all right, probably could use a guard, you know? Dennis Daly, Greg Gould's going to slide over now to left tackle. We could use a guard or a tackle. And then you flip to the defense. We could use corner three. We could use a strong safety. So looking at where we're at, pick 13. We'll save quarterback for last because we already see Trey Lance there. That's actually kind of an obvious selection. So at strong safety, we have a chance that we got three, you know, positive looking reports here. Obviously, being able to get one of these two would be ideal. Mid-second round for Nasruddin from Florida State. Mid-second round here for Caden Sturges of Texas. There's a very good chance we get those guys on the swing. I do not want to get them at pick 13. Looking at corner, Farley from Virginia Tech. He'd actually be a nice-looking player. Sean Wade, that'd actually be a very good-looking player there in the second year. Corner three. But then it's all about priorities. Pick 13, grabbing corner three. Is that really where we should be allocating our picks? Or should we, again, much like the second round, someone like Adebo, Stokes could slip. McQuamu, Tyson Campbell, Joe Horn's kid, Sanjay Samuel's kid. Like, there's some good corners there in the second round. So then you just move, like, well, where else could we go? We could go D-tackle two, even though K'Wan Short's playing at a high level. Some, you know, a lot more legitimate first-round talents here. Twyman, Tufele, Christian Barmore. And then you still, I mean, look at that. Day fourth round, third round. Still value there. Shelvin, Stills, Mathis, Teron Vincent, Kyrie Campbell. Those are all guys that would be more inclined to come in as D-tackle three and then be able to eventually overtake K'Wan Short, who's most likely going to regress sooner than later. But again, just I don't feel like we need to, especially K'Wan Short being our most productive player on the defensive line last year, we don't have to immediately replace him right now. But you have the ugly stat line there. Maybe the offensive line could get improved. Redunce from North Dakota State going on the inside. I mean, there's not really any first-rounders. So that's more, you know, day two, day three picks. At tackle, we could get Carmen, the big tackle from Clemson. Could get, I mean, the tackles here actually aren't particularly good. Looks like a goddamn Madden-generated class. So my argument is, clearly we should be going quarterback. Which one do you want to see? We have, I think, for me, there are four. There could be an argument made that these all four of these guys, I mean, Mac Jones, third-round talent, probably shouldn't. But there's an argument that Trask, Wilson, and Trey Lance all could go in the first round. And I wouldn't, as a Gator fan, Gator bias, if someone wanted me to, per se, reach for Kyle Trask in the first round, I wouldn't hate it if that was overwhelmingly the direction you guys wanted to go. But we're much more going to cue in here on Zach Wilson, the breakout quarterback for BYU, which is not really a big breakout because he was outstanding as a true freshman for BYU, and he was injured, banged up the last couple years. Or do we just go with the obvious, go with the guy that kind of makes the most sense anyways, and bring in Trey Lance? I'm going to let you guys decide, though. In the comment section below, let me know who we should draft here in this franchise. There could be a lot of Teddy Bridgewater stands that absolutely say, do not go quarterback, get a tackle, get a D-tackle, get one of those D-tackles, get a corner, something like that. And if honestly that direction you want me to go, sure. Or if you want me to draft a quarterback, let me know. Pound the table for your guy, and I will draft the guy that we as a community should think be the franchise for the Carolina Panthers. But that will do it for me today, guys. Thank you for watching. As always, first time stopping by, don't be afraid to hit that subscribe button. Smash the like button if you enjoyed. We'll be back tomorrow with episode 2 of our Philadelphia Eagles franchise. And then on Thursday, we will have the next follow-up of this where we draft our quarterback for the Panthers. So make sure you stay tuned. Keep an eye on your sub boxes. Smash that like button. Helps the video in the little YouTube algorithm. If you want people to see into my content, it really, really helps me out. And I'll see you guys back here in the next one. Peace out.